it's never the same. So I look forward to seeing it. Now he's got that stretch back thing. He's not wearing a bun yet, though. I still don't get the bun thing, but everybody has a bun. My nephews have a bun. I say to my nephews, I don't understand the bun. You know, my hair was long. I didn't do the bun. And they explain it to me, which is very fond of them. But I do appreciate that. But he does. I'm the boring shaved head look, and it's sometimes it's browner than others depending on the sunshine, where I am. But his is always different, and I always like it, and I'm always jealous. I mean, that's basically the bottom line. What a great honor it is, and continues to be, for Linda and I to be a part of not only your pastors. Families, all of them, Sam's and Gary's, but to be a part of this church and to be a part of its history, but more importantly, part of its future. We certainly stand at a moment of a crossroad now, at a turning point, and another dimension of and another apprehension of the Lord's promise. We are certainly there in Father's house. I want to speak to it today and through the week, really. Before I do that, though, one final commercial. The worship remains incredibly sick in this place. Just does. I mean, we have the great pleasure, which I do because I'm tone deaf basically and have no real sound. Just have that white man overbite thing that, you know, I've mixed a few things with it, you know, like this, fist up, but it's basically the same inner movement. I can't feel it. So fortunately, I have friends who love to play the sound, and I feel it, but I can't release it. You know, that is terrible. It's terrible. It's having wine in a bottle, but it stays corked up forever, and it's just how it is. So, but can we, you know, it takes a lot to do this. I know that because of the time in pastoring and the time that I love my worshiping friends. Can we just let them know this morning in an early service for them not to be lazy or just kind of going through the motions, but to really apprehend the Lord every single time I'm here. So can we just let the worship team know how much we appreciate them? Yeah. They're all amazing, but that drummer, man, I just wanted to jump up in his chest and say, hit him, man, hit him. Yeah, I did. It is an amazing anniversary, which I had thought and considered all year, and then Pastor Chuck and I were talking as we were driving in our mutual friend's red Corvette with the top down yesterday, which is really nice. It was. It's the 20th anniversary of Father's House. I'm sure you know that. Most of us and most of our friends that we relate to don't so much rely on or set a moment of time by anniversary dates, but I do believe that this one is very critical. It's an amazing number in our biblical history. When you saw Moses' tabernacle, if you looked at it, it had the number 20 all through it in its height, its dimensions, all of its boards. I can't spend any time on these. But when the children of Israel looked at it, it spoke to them. It always did. Everything the Lord built had a voice to the people because they saw it. Even though much of it was hidden, it still had a voice. Even sometimes when our God isn't so visible to us, he, because of who he is, still has a voice to us even when he's not speaking. The next building that will be built will be Solomon's temple in the earth. In its entryways and all through the temple is the number 20. It's all over it, even in sacrifices and dimensions of it. Ezekiel's temple being so specific, and this is a beautiful thing about our God. He is so specific, always building things according to the pattern that the heavenlies have introduced to us. Always. All through Ezekiel's temple, the number 20 is so critical, so important. Here's the number. For those of you who like it, we don't live by the number system in our Hebrew understanding of it. But when it's there, it's vital that we know it. Here is what it means. It is two tens. It means anticipation in the divine. Or, I like, divine anticipation. Without us realizing it, every one of us, when we got born again, had this new thump, the thump. We had something inside of us that we were looking for something, for someone. The writer of Hebrews will write in the Hebrew letter, will say, Abraham looked for a city whose builder and maker was God that had foundations. Abraham never saw the city. He would never see it. It would be thousands of years before it would ever be appear. It is really a New Testament thing, though it's not a physical building. It will be one. But he was looking for something. He was anxious. He couldn't find it. There was something about him. It didn't mean that he was irritated or us be irritated, but sometimes we do. We're frustrated because we're looking for something that we know God wants to do, but we can't find it. It's like the Spirit of God. You want to hold on to him, box him in, but he's like the wind and he's like the water. Have you ever tried to hold either one of them? I've tried to hold water. It just slips through my hands because the Spirit of God is going to be governed by one person and one person only. But he loves us and wants to move in us. I want to bring us to a story this morning, and I want to speak some things to us because this is going to be a week of revived hope, of renewed hope, of hope beyond hope, that we might be a people who lay our hopes not in what a government will decide, not in whom, though I believe in being involved in all of our government ways, all of our government things. I do believe in pray for them. I have my own times of fasting and travail. I believe in voting. I think we're a part of it. But that is not where our hope is. Our hope remains and our anticipation remains. And what does the divine desire to do in our day? Has he forgotten us? I don't think so. Has he been waiting for us? Oh, yeah. Because he was here before we ever got here. And he had a hope and a dream for us and for our day long before we ever considered it. It's in all of us. And this week I want to awaken it. That we believe with expectation when there seems to be no way we can have expectation. There's no way we can have hope. There's no way that we can dream. There's no way he could do what he's saying he's going to do. It's not possible. We're going to realize by the end of the week, we don't live in the possible. We're born from there so that we would always live in the impossible. The impossible, it would be where we live. We're the only ones who carry hope in this world. In a day and time, it is 15 years ago. I'm in New York a lot, and I've been here in New York in September for many, many years. Just the last years, I haven't. And they still bring the flags down, and every firehouse in New York will shut down, and they'll walk the streets. And when you're there, because I live so close to it, I still feel the feel of this day 15 years ago. I still feel the effect of it. I don't want to forget it. It's not that I'm angry or fisting. It's not that kind of thing. But it awakened us to the reality, not about an enemy, but about an everlasting God who we can hope for when it appears there is no hope. There's the bells. See that? How could I time that? That's right. A little thunder while the sun's out would really be a sign for us. Let's pray. Father, I thank you. The incredible joy and honor. Excuse me. For me to be a part of this church, Father's House, the 20th anniversary of its beginnings. Let hope, by divine inspiration, be in all of us. Personally, for our families, for our city, for our country, for our generation and the generations, but especially for Father's House. Let us embrace you in a fresh way. Let us see you like we've never seen you. Let the revelation of Jesus Christ and the revelation of your intention be ours this week. Father, I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. For a time, I'm not going to read the scriptures. I just want to bring us to a point of history. It's the second year of Saul's kingship. There is war with the Philistines. There will always be war with the Philistines all the years of King Saul's reign. King Saul has gathered and brought his army to a ravine area. He is in Gibeah. All of this great army, they are the elite of the army. We will see them again in almost 15 or 16 years, almost 17 years. Just so we know time, David is not yet born yet. Goliath is the biggest in his class. But he's still growing. Just so you know time. David hasn't even arrived. In Mishmash are the Philistine garrison. They would have spoilers. See, the Philistines were born for war, much like the Spartans. Many of us know the Spartans better than the Philistines, but they are much like this. They would send out these spoilers. And thank you, my friend. Love the beard, too, which I can't grow yet. Hopefully, when I'm out of puberty, I'll be able to have a beard. I'm just waiting. You know, I figured maybe around 70. Now I'm 60, so I'm figuring another decade now. I'll be able to have some hair over here. Maybe. We'll see. Some here would be nice. Miracle grow for the hair would work. Anyways, back to the story. They would send out spoilers. And you see, I want you to see the picture. The children of Israel, the army of Israel, they're hiding in holes and dens and caves. They're afraid of the Philistines. They've always been afraid of them. There between them is a little ravine, a dried up riverbed. And there's these cliffs that are jagged. They're given names because in the southern one, the sun would hit it, and the glare of it would be so great. Some say it was like granite. They're not really sure, but they were these sheer cliffs, almost unclimbable between them. That's where the Philistines set up their garrison so that they would be away, and that they're almost untouchable. They were at a standstill. Nothing was happening. Boy, I'm coming to say several things to us. Because of the fear of the army of God and again, the king's fear, the people of God were just sitting there doing nothing while the Philistines began to come toward them and after them. Jonathan, his son, is probably at this time 20, 21, 22. He's a lot older than David. So when we understand that they're going to be close, David's not even born yet. He'll be almost 20 years David Sr. I love this man. I'm in 1 Samuel 14, just so you know. I love young Jonathan. There is no smith in Israel. When the children of Israel wanted to sharpen their blades, they would have to go to the Philistines for that. There were only two swords. Think about this, two swords in the entire army. The army was made up of farmers. They had little sickles, little hammers. That was all they had. They had no weapons. Saul had a sword, and Jonathan had a sword. Jonathan is, in the story, almost, though it's not there, pacing. He doesn't like that this standstill, this waiting. So he begins to pace a little bit, and he says to his armor bearer, now you got the picture, right? Two swords against an army of people who are born for war. Jonathan's pacing, and he finally looks at his armor bearer. He goes, hey, the armor bearer usually is a man that he's known almost his whole life. They were close. They were like the father's house men, you know? And he says, listen, you know what? I got an idea. Why don't you and I go up against those Philistines? Yeah, I mean, listen, God, he can deliver by many or few. What do you think? I love the armor bearer. Let me see. You got a sword. I have a shield. Saul has a sword. And you and I are going to go up against them. Now, if I could step out of this, let me do the math. Okay. But I see, I love these two, though. I want to begin here this morning and with the second service. I want to say a little bit more to them because of our time. But I love this hope that's in these two in an impossible moment, an impossible situation. Who knows? What can God do with many or with few? So the armor bearer says to him, dude, give me five. And he says, all right. So as they're walking, you with me with the picture? They're walking down this ravine. There's a cliff behind them in Gibeah. His father's sitting in his tent. It's a stalemate. No one's moving. Actually, that's how the enemy likes it. the people of God just staying in their holes, staying in their dens, staying in their caves, just stay there. And so they're walking, and Jonathan says, okay, here's the plan. When we get there, if they find us, which they will, and they say to us, stay down there, we're going to come down to you, then we won't move. But if they say to us, come on up here, we'll show you a thing or two, then we'll know God has delivered them into our hand. Now, I got to step out of the story again. Okay, now, did you pray and fast over this? Did God speak to you about this plan? I mean, this is kind of quick. I mean, we've taken 10 steps, what, maybe 50 yards, and all of a sudden, this is the plan. Is this a word from God? Did a prophet give this to you? I mean, where did you get this? I mean, wouldn't you want to say something? That's it? If they come here, we stay, don't do nothing. But if they say, come on up here, God has given. I mean, how is this a plan? I love this. Again, the armorer goes, sweet. I mean, how do you hope like this? How can you believe like this? How can you have any anticipation this just might even be God? How? Where's the testimony? Do we have two witnesses here? Let's find out. No. It's just two guys willing to believe. You know what? Who knows what he just might be willing to do? So they get down to the end of the ravine, and they look up, and the garrison looks down. They're already nervous now. If you read 1 Samuel 14, they look down, and they think, the Israelites must be coming out of their dens. They're getting a little nervous now that the people of God might be stepping out. They might be believing. They might be coming out from where they were. They might be taking a chance. They might be taking a faith. They don't really know. And so they look down, and they see him, and they say to Jonathan, and his arm bearer, come on up here. We'll show you a thing or two. I mean, they must have looked at each other and thought, yeah, did you hear that? Give me some now. That's it. Fist good. Thanks for helping me. You must know this, though. Because sometimes we think, well, if it's God, there's no effort. Oh, no, not so. Just because it's God, that it's going to just come super easy and there's not going to be any kind of effort on our part. Oh, no, not so. I used to think the same thing. I think, well, if it's God, that means there's no sweat. Oh, no, it doesn't mean a thing. Thanks to Adam, we sweat everything we do. So that's why when we get up there, we're all going to kick him in the shin at one time. Stupid. Because you have to sweat on my brow. That's right. So what Jonathan, and I love the explanation in 1 Samuel, Jonathan and his armor bearer are crawling up on their hands and their knees on this jagged edge. I love this. They don't look at it and say, well, we can't get up there. Do you see his stairs? This doesn't look easy. This is kind of difficult. On their hands and knees, they're climbing to the top, believing God. Here's the beautiful thing about this story, because I started with this number 20. When they arrive, Jonathan, I don't know what the armor bearer is doing. Hitting them with his, I don't know how he fought. Kicked them in their shin. I don't know, punched over his. They're warriors with swords. He's up there fighting them. I don't know, with his shield. What? Jonathan, here's the beautiful thing. He slays 20 men. Now, I love my Bible, but when I am reading it, I've got to look at it as I'm reading it. I got to listen to it as it's speaking to me. That's why I love my Bible. I'm thinking right away, I know the number 20, and I'm thinking, 20 men, why not 18, 17, 13? Because out of this, the Lord is saying something, not only to them, but to us in history. 20 men he slays in this acreage of an area. All of a sudden, as he slays them, all of the Philistines think that the entire army of Israel has come out of their dens, caves. They begin slaying each other. Saul goes up and goes, what's going on? Listen, and immediately the earth quakes. What? Oh, okay. That was an accidental earthquake, right?
like, is Gary, does Gary, Pastor Gary multitask or what? Yeah. I mean, look at him. I mean, there's nothing he won't do. He's an absolute treasure to the Father's house. We know that, though, right? Yeah, so we could just give it up for him just a second anyways, a little bit more.
That's good. All right, it's going to be hard to preach now. I'm going to have to go like this. I'll fall over if I keep doing one hand. The earth quakes. It is a divine thing. Can you imagine, I don't know, moments ago, maybe 4 or 5 hours earlier, a stalemate is in place. The people of God are so afraid to move, so afraid to believe, and they're the elite of the people of God. The other folks who are in their homes are just hiding, but these are the elite. They're the Father's house group, if you don't mind. Can you imagine that this young man and his armor bearer just willing to believe that God might be willing to do something they've never seen before? Though there's such terror and fear and such uncertainty of the future, even at that moment, there are spoilers coming their way. This young man, he's probably 20, 21. It isn't about the age. It's about the hope that lies within us. It's about the hope that was in him and his armor bearer. Two swords. Everything spoke impossible. Everything said it can't happen. Everything spoke against the possibility of God ever doing anything. But these two men, just willing to believe God might be able to deliver with many or with few. He took down 20 men. You've got to know that the Philistines turned on each other. They started fighting each other because they were so afraid they didn't know what was happening. And the earth quaked. I love the armor bearer. I'm going to close. I'm done. I love the armor bearer. I still remain an armor bearer. What is that? It's a young man, I said, knew Jonathan. They grew up together, just like we would. He stood with him, no matter what. He was with him and believing God. I made fun of it. I'm going to press it a little bit more in the second service because of the time. I mean, any guy in his right mind would have said, excuse me, will you give me your sword? You take my shield. We'll go. Where was this plan? I mean, did you get this in the law of Moses? Did you read it somewhere? Did somebody tell you this? How is it possible that you're even thinking like this? Plus, your father is so off the target, off the mark. What are you doing? I mean, maybe God doesn't want to do anything. Maybe we're really at a time of an end, of a moment that's finishing. Maybe there's nothing that's going to happen. But he says none of that. I'm an armor bearer to my original pastor, and then a second one who he knows. I'm standing here as his and his family's and an armor bearer to this church. It doesn't matter my weaponry. You know what the greatest weapon we can have is? Do what's in your heart. I just texted a young man who lost his church this morning, who is really so broken over what's happened and the many things. And I just said to him, I'm believing for you and believing for your family. Hold on to what's in your heart. Despite what we're facing, that's the armor bearer spirit. I want us to be a church of armor bearers. I want us to take up armor bearer, not just Father's house, but the whole Christian community in Longview, the whole Christian community in Washington State, the whole Christian community in the United States, and those of you who believe for the world to change, let us be armor bearers for the ministry in the world, the whole church. Let us say to the church, yo, do what's in your heart. Who knows what God might be willing to do? It isn't a question of the numbers. It's a question of him. It is divine anticipation. Or anticipation and divine. I love Jonathan. I don't have time to talk about the names of these cliffs. I won't do it in the next service either. Or this bed or what was really happening. So many beautiful words are in this story. But I love Jonathan. He's not mad at his father, though. His father's going to make so many blunders. He's going to make another blunder in just a few moments, risking the life of his son. But he's just there. I got to tell you, I'm there, just pacing a little bit. The stalemate.
Well, what about the Philistines? Who cares what the army's planned? Who cares about the spoilers? It doesn't matter about them. It doesn't matter about them. Yeah, but what about the church? And what about the people of God? They're hiding in dens and caves. They're fearful. They have no hope. It doesn't matter about them. It matters about us. Right here in this room. And this young man has this anticipation in the divine. He doesn't know what God will do, but he has a sense that if he does something, he will follow in suit. He has no idea the Lord's going to shake the ground. I could only imagine. Can I just step up here for a second? I just have fun with these stories. The Lord was kind of like bored as usual. Oh, man, this generation just isn't interested. Okay, well, I'll take care of them and feed them as I always do, because pretty soon I'm going to have them write a song that I'm a good, good father, because they don't believe it. They don't really believe it, so I'm going to have to kind of inspire them to write it so they'll start to believe it. They have forgotten already that a whole generation hated me and disobeyed me, but I fed them, watched over them, clothed them, kept the enemy away, and even brought water out of a rock because it's what I do. Please hear that. I don't care what Wall Street says. I don't care what the government says. I don't care about anything. We're his. If he has to open up water in my backyard and have a raven fly over my house and drop, well, a little fried chicken on Monday and let me see, maybe some steak on Tuesday and I don't know. And I don't know how it's going to do, but drop some cans of pasta sauce so Linda can make pasta for me on Wednesday. This would be really good. I don't know how we'll do it, but he'll do it. He might probably was like, all the angels are like, what's going on? Well, Jonathan, anybody? Jonathan, did you see this? What? Even Jesus, who hasn't come yet, is by his side as the word, right? What's going on? Well, look at Jonathan. Did you hear what he said? No, what did he say? He said, well, who knows what I'll do? It doesn't take many, even few. I mean, she got out there probably like, man, yeah, I am almighty. Hey, what up? And he actually got stoked that someone might be willing to believe him. And he was already planning. I'm sure the angels and the beasts were going, what's he thinking? I don't know if he told him. He goes, I'm going to shake the earth. Watch. I don't know. What did he do? Blow on it? Did he put his hand and shake it? Did he say earthquake? Did the earth just quake because someone believed the creator? I don't know. Don't you love the sections of the Bible that aren't there so that we could kind of dream a little? I don't know why it quaked or how it quaked, but it quaked. And the Philistines stood on that ground and went, what on earth is going on? I'll tell you what's going on earth. Someone's believing. Someone has an anticipation in the divine. I want it to be us. Stand with me just for a moment. I'm being very serious. We're living in a day. It isn't just the young, so I'm a little irritated. I have a great advantage to be with the young, be with the middle, and be with the older. And the older say, well, the young aren't taking the responsibility. Well, maybe they're not, but I don't care about that. How about you take your responsibility? But I need a nation of armor bearers. Maybe you're young this morning, and all you think about is you. Maybe you're in the middle, somewhere from 18 to 40, and all you think about is you, wondering when somebody should do something for you. Maybe you're 40 and up and still think that. Or maybe you've lost the passion to be the armor bearer. It is a moment where this young man was going to risk his life for his friend, just to say to his friend, you know what, I'm with you. That's an armor bearer. Go, go, go. How about this morning we all make a decision? Begin with me, Lord. Help me to be an armor bearer to my friends. Let me encourage my friends. Listen, believe God. Well, you don't know what's going on in my life. I really don't, but let's believe God. Well, I come from a bad family. It doesn't matter. Let's believe God. Well, I haven't seen him yet. Doesn't matter. If he has to quake the earth for you, he'll quake it. We're standing at an anniversary. I believe without question the Lord has come to strengthen our hope, give hope where hope wasn't, that we would be willing to reach for to him and believe for the absolute impossible. That we're moving out of the probable and we're moving out of the possible. That we don't need signs in the sky and signs anywhere. We have a sign, and it is he is our God. And he's the one who's laid in us an anticipation in him. I want it revived in us. For those weary of us, that we'll be strengthened. The hopeless in us, that we'll have hope. Even the young ones who've begun to run, that we would be able to fly, get off the ground and start to fly like eagles. Are you good with that? Yep. Father, I'm asking for this to just overtake us. Begin with me, as I've said. Begin with me and my generation. Erupted in my dad's generation. Let us believe you. It doesn't matter the circumstance, the situation. Let the 20 arise in us. That's what I love. They'll say to me, how old are you? And I say, 20. They go, yeah, right. And they go, they don't know what I'm talking about. Let the divine anticipation, let anticipation arise in us. Yep. Move us out of the probable into the unprobable. Let us move out of the possible to the impossible. We are born to live in what cannot be, because it is. Father, I thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. How about giving the Lord a hand? Amen. All right, do you mind just sitting down? Just take a few more minutes. Beautiful. Are you okay?